The U.S. Open is special. It's hard. You know it's going to be hard walking in the door.
Huge shot.
Here.
All 10 down.
Whoever wins this tournament really deserves it.
It's a marathon. It's not a sprint. The longest format, the most amount of games, the toughest condition.
It's a major, and it's the most challenging one we have.
To be honest, I just feel like sometimes it's so hard that is, you feel so discouraged.
The U.S. Open is definitely the most prestigious event. It's the longest format, and the lanes are always very difficult.
The best bowler is going to win this tournament.
Strong shot, 1-3 pocket, 60 feet to success there for Liz Johnson.
It's just a challenging event.
It beats you into the ground, and only the strongest come out the other end.
One mistake, one frame, can knock you all the way out.
Shoot it, shoot it!
Around the 10, open frame.
In this event, the cream definitely rises to the top.
Welcome to Chicago, welcome to Addison, and welcome to the 2016 U.S. Women's Open. There'll be some spectacular bowling here at Stardust in Addison, and an enthusiastic crowd, and why not? Because we have five outstanding bowlers who have fought their way through brutally tough conditions to make the step ladder finals. Hello again, everybody. I'm Dave Lamont. Thank you very much for joining us. Spoke with Liz Johnson yesterday. She'll be in the first match against Kelly Kulik, and I asked her about the conditions. She told me these are the toughest U.S. Open conditions she has ever faced. She has won this event four previous times, and she is in our first match as we show you the step ladder. What an opening match we have for you. The winners of four of the last five Opens will face off in the first match, Liz Johnson versus Kelly Kulik. Then Nubi Fenn from Singapore, also from Singapore, Shayna Ng, and then the left-hander, an explosive scorer, Shannon Kluhowski, in the number one position. And I am joined here by a three-time major winner herself and a survivor. She made it all the way through match play, Carolyn Doran Ballard. How hard were the conditions?
Well, this could be one of the toughest U.S. Opens I've ever competed in. It was a 39-foot pattern, and let me tell you, there were three key factors that I think the girls would agree upon. Number one, if you were a right-hander, do whatever you had to do to hit the 1-3. If you were a left-hander, do whatever you had to do to hit the 1-2. Number two, whatever you left, you better make the spare. And number three, long format, a lot of games, stay mentally tough because you are never out of it.
Well, in the number one position is Shannon Kluhowski, and see you standing by right now with another one of our Hall of Famers, Kim Adler. Kim?
Well, we have Shannon here, and I just want to ask you, wow, what a great week you've had. How does somebody go from 24th to first on this tough lane condition?
We started the cashers round and we didn't have a very good luck. So Rob and I just decided we were going to camp out playing in and we were just going to try different balls and stay in the same part. And luckily it worked and we just kept riding the same wave. Being the only lefty, it didn't change much pair to pair.
Very, very good for you. Good luck today.
Thank you.
So Shannon Kluhowski is going to have to wait and watch a while, and everyone's going to want to watch this match. Liz Johnson, Kelly Kulik. Combination 12 major championships between these two coming up next. Inside Stardust in Addison, Illinois, a suburb of Chicago. And what an incredible opening match. This is a match that bowling fans around the world are going to want to watch. On the right, Liz Johnson. On the left, Kelly Kulik. And the first of our stepladder finals, Liz, the number four seed, Kelly, the number five seed. Circumstances, Carolyn, got so unusual near the end there in the position round. Liz actually benefited Kelly, who did not have a good final game, in her victory over Jody Golic.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, that's one of the things about the U.S. Open. It, you know, if you look at who was in the top 10 and at some point down to the top 16, matches were going left and right, and first through that 10th place were changing every game. Like I said, in the Open, you could never give up and count yourself out because Kelly wound up shooting that big game in the seventh game right before position round, which shot her right up to third place.
278, I had a chance to watch that game. And then she ends up, I think, with around 174 in the eighth game. So Liz starts us off. Solidly into the pocket for the four-time U.S. Open champion.
Now you're going to see two different things here. Liz, once we talked about 39-foot pattern, usually allows you to play multiple angles. Liz is playing further to the right. Now you're going to see Kelly step up, playing way deep from the very start, which is where the majority of the field played throughout the week.
And through the nose, and Kelly's got early problems. She is a three-time U.S. Open champion, the last of those victories in 2012. And Liz, of course, is the defending champion.
And this is what I'm going to say numerous times throughout this show. Looks like a great shot. Kelly's ball during the practice shots was coming in just a little bit light. She softened up on it a little bit, went a little high. But here is the trait of the pattern. You saw this a lot. That split right there, you saw that a lot on good shots. Because right now, the lanes haven't tamed down enough. Hey, they only had a few minutes of practice. There's only five girls on the pair. It's probably going to take just a little bit for this transition to take place. And from there, Kelly will make her adjustment.
She was working on her bowling balls about an hour before we started and trying to get them. It was interesting. She was telling me that she wanted a more aggressive ball, but yet it would finish more passively.
Absolutely. Surface, ball speed was so crucial this week.
And also through the nose, but she gets a trip on the four and the nine. Let's take a look at our USBC future for the sport lane pattern.
It's simple. This pattern, 39 feet. Again, I said anything between 39 and 41 feet usually allows for multiple angles. You can see so much in the front part of this pattern. It's flat. That's why the lanes got so tough, is that oil carried down and the girls were playing different parts of the lane. The oil was going everywhere. That's why spares were so crucial.
And Liz, 10 straight back for the second straight frame.
I was watching the girls practice during the few minutes before the match started. And I did think if they tried to play further right and push the oil to where it needed to be, and they started further right and then migrated left, I thought the pattern would hold up a little bit better. Also, it would give them probably a little bit better angle to the pocket where Shannon is going to be the only left-hander. She can do whatever she wants on her side.
It's got a hurry, and it does. And so Liz Johnson opens with a turkey.
Liz playing, getting the ball out to about 6-7. She actually got that one a little more left to right. A little bit softer with the ball speed today. Ball rolled right up. Those light hits carried really well this week.
That's going to cross over, and that happened to Kelly a little bit yesterday, too.
Mm-hmm. The right lane, she's using a ball that gets down the lane and hooks a little bit more on the back end. A little bit less surface, so it's shiny, going to get down the lane. She's using a little bit more of aggressive ball on the left lane, so she sees them different already. But here's the key to the right lane for the right-handers. Can't get deep enough. You're going to have to start walking around the ball return here in the next few games.
And every spare is a victory in this tournament, as tough as the conditions have been.
Kelly gets her ball right into her swing on that second step, but look at the power. She's collapsing that right knee, and then she just stays with it, head a little bit forward over that knee, but my gosh, she never closes down on it and never grabs it. She is smooth as silk from the top to the bottom. She just lets that swing drop.
That's got to hurry. They over-adjusted that time, not surprisingly.
A little bit, but again, and I'm going to really try not to repeat myself. She did get this ball a little bit further right down lane, but she did collapse in the 4-9, so I can see why she made the adjustment, but this is what you're going to see. If you got the ball too far down the lane, it didn't want to recover, yet there is no hold on this pattern. So you have to create the angle with your ball speed. And that's how he created hold was with ball speed.
And trying to get that little pocket on the 2-4, she missed the 2 and has left a swinging gate for Liz Johnson to walk right into here. By the way, any player who bowls a 300 game on our CBS Sports Network Finals will receive a $10,000 bonus from the PWBA. And Liz 4-for-4. Look, if there's anybody you don't want to let in your kitchen with a mistake is Liz.
No, and this is amazing. This is what makes Liz one of the greatest. She plays a condition to her strength. Watch here. Again, her last shot was a little more left to right. This one, definitely more in front of her. Straight up 6-7. A little bit more ball speed, a little softer on the left lane. Here's the key to Liz. Last night, her last four games, she was irritated. She shot 180, 180, 180, 180, her first four games. She jumped right, bombed them, and got her way to the show.
That one's not going to make the difference. So her strike streak will stop. But a good start for Liz. And again, you can string 3-4 together. That's an outstanding effort here at this pattern, in addition to the fact that it's such an important tournament on the calendar, the third of four majors this year for the ladies. Liz, a 7-time major champion, 4-time U.S. Open champion. Kelly, 5 majors. And now that we have a Hall of Famer next to me, I have a Hall of Famer as our sideline reporter, Kim Adler. Kim.
Well, I've just been watching and listening, and the temperature in here, I just wanted to make a mention of that. All week is very, very warm in the bowling center, and this will help a lot with the lane condition transitions. It's a lot cooler in here, even with the TV lights, and I wonder how that'll make a difference for the players.
Kelly trying to make an adjustment. She has, and she gets him there. That's a nice adjustment. She doesn't seem happy with it, but I bet she is on the inside.
Still playing left. Let's see where's the ball. Crossing about 19 out to about 11, out to 9, really. Comes in light. And honestly, here's the key. I wouldn't move off that shot because you really can't.
Boy, she got a break there. Late trip on the 4-7 and the 9. And the future Hall of Famer comes through with a double as she tries to make a stand against Liz Johnston, who has a 44-pin lead. But you can't count Kelly Kulick out. We'll return with more U.S. Women's Open action in a moment. So there is the situation. Liz Johnston with a front four and then converted a 1-2-4. In the fifth, there's Chad Murphy, Executive Director of the United States Bowling Congress, on hand here, of course. He always gets good seats, Chad. He does.
He should have a good seat. He was very instrumental in bringing back the PWBA.
So here's Liz working on a spare. Through the face, and she gets a little break. 3-6-10 isn't anybody's friend, but that could have been a lot worse.
Liz playing much further right, sliding about, and from here I can see maybe about 15. She missed a little left on that. Like we said, it didn't matter if we were playing in or out. There was no hold, so you still had to execute.
And you talked about this in the Open. Frames, these matches can turn on a single shot that doesn't go your way. Liz with a surprising error there, chopping off the three, and all of a sudden Kelly started this down 44. She's now down 29 and working a double.
Well, it's amazing because really Liz and Kelly, two of the greatest by far for women's bowling. Number two, they are the best spare shooters. So very, you don't see that often out of Liz or Kelly.
Let's see how she bounces back. Oh, wrap around 10. That was a fantastic roll by Liz.
Great shot, a little bit more direct. Increased her ball speed just a little bit, keeping it more in front of her. High flush, pin wraps right around the 10. Good shot.
Very high percentage she was going to make that spare. Are you looking for some fantastic PWBA gear? Then visit the official online store of the PWBA at shoppwba.com. So Kelly Kulick, there's a little chance here for Kelly.
Kelly changed balls. The ball she was using on the left lane, she is now also using on the right lane.
I'm not going to hurry back fast enough. You could hear right away she groaned as soon as that left her hand.
No, and she said during the commercial break, she looked up at me and she said, "Straighter looks better, Carolyn." I said, "Well, maybe a little bit." Way left, and I can't tell from here. She could be sliding 42, 44. She got that one way right down lane. Like we said, even earlier in the game, if you got it too far to the right, it just never recovered, yet there is no hold. So, you know, your first shot just was so critical.
So your point was she should stick with the shot that brought her a strike a few frames ago. Did she there?
Here's the thing. You know, I know it didn't look like a good shot, but on this type of condition, she could have executed it the way she wanted to. It's just the lanes continued to change. The shot was so touchy. Now, that one, unfortunately, you could hear out of her mouth. Yeah. She really didn't like it. But there were some shots you threw, and, you know, the result just wasn't what you thought it would be.
There you see an amazing statistic, 6 straight finals appearance in this event. That's her best roll so far, 10 straight back for Kelly. And throws it right back at Liz Johnson, although Kelly's running out of frames.
Much, much better shot on this left lane. Laydown's at least 25, 26. Getting out to 9-10, that's a great shot. And she's so soft at the bottom. You know, Kelly never hits up on it. Just a true student of the game.
Ah. Well, I don't know what she didn't like about that. So we take a look at recent winners of the U.S. Women's Open, and you're going to see two names that you're looking at bold. A lot of Kelly Kulik and Liz Johnson. Because we did not have an event in 2014, but look at that. Leanne Hulsenberg, of course, won at the stadium, at Cowboy Stadium. Kelly in 2010. Kelly won the outdoor event in Reno in 2012. So, and Leanne also made it to match play and was threatening to make the show. It's another person who was so suited for this format as Leanne.
Oh, my God, absolutely. Her game, her ball roll, her mental game, everything. She has worked really hard at getting back to her peak performance and has done really well this year.
And Liz will leave a standing 7. I didn't want to forget about Jody Golic, the amateur from nearby Schaumburg. That's who ended up 6th, who bowled so well against Liz. They actually both bowled 232 in the position round. And Jody needed to win and needed to win by a certain number of pins. But she, a McKendree grad and a name to really keep an eye on in the PWBA.
Yeah, I actually had the pleasure of bowling with her in Detroit at the PWBA stop this year. And not only was she just a pleasure to be around, what a great young bowler. I mean, just, you know, from point A to point B, rock solid, really working hard on a mental game, and just, it's, you know, just going to be the future of what women's bowling is all about.
Peace. And that 10 is, no, that's not going to go for Kelly. And her max 210 just shrunk. Yeah, you can hear her say, the more left I go, and then we should fade it out on us there.
Which is, once again, she did like this shot. She moved again, didn't get it as far right, and just went a little bit high and left the 4-7-10. And once again, one of the splits you saw constantly this week at the Open.
And Liz Johnson has won this match, and she will move on to face Niu Wei Fen from Singapore in the next match. So Kelly, you can put her down to possibly make this show again next year for this event.
And I'd like to give a shout-out to Kelly's mom. And I still call her Mrs. Kulik, so she'll get mad at me when she sees me, that's for sure. But I'd like to give a shout-out to Kelly's mom. Hope she's feeling a little better.
Okay.
She's going through some health issues, but we want her to know that we're all thinking about her and sending our prayers. And her daughter's doing a great job out here for women's bowling.
Absolutely. She's not only a tremendous player, but a tremendous spokesman for the game.
A lot more than the right.
Somebody, she likes the left a lot more than the right. Somebody who is always at the forefront promoting the sport all around the globe.
Key factor there to what Kelly just said, left lane for the right-handers, you have plenty of lane. You have plenty of approach to move. You can continue to move left.
So Liz Johnson, the defending champion, is a little bit closer to winning again. But now she's going to face a very talented boulder from Singapore in Nu Wei Fen. We'll have that match for you when we return. So Liz Johnson moves on the stepladder and moves up another rung as she defeats Kelly Kulik 207 to 168. Liz, steady, just the one mistake in the sixth frame and ended up not costing her. And the defending champion just outside of Chicago here. Look at the great city, and we show you some other finishes. We talk about Joni Gawlick. She was spectacular. Claudia Guerrero almost made the show. Rocio Restrepo, April Ellis had a very nice event. So did Jazz Tan. Leanne Hulsenberg, we talked about how suited she is for this format. Danielle McEwen and Deandra Asbady, a native who said it was really nice. I could just go home when the day was done and go back to my family. Also finishing in the top 24, Missy Parkin. Allie Ijams had a nice event. Carrie Smith, Jody Wester, another veteran who does well in this kind of format. And there, number 24, Carolyn Doran Ballard. And she had an up-close and personal look at these conditions and how difficult they have been. And hearing very good things, by the way, about Daria Pajak out of Poland. Talked to Chris Barnes, who watches Daria's game. And Chris had some very good things to say about the future for this young Polish bowler. We are at Stardust Bowl in Addison. They've had plenty of major events before here. Last year, the Junior Gold Championships were held here. And we are about ready for our next match. But first, let's go over. Kim Adler is standing by with Kelly Kulik.
So an unfortunate match for you, Kelly. Sorry about that. Tell me about lanes 7 and 8. We didn't use that during the tournament. Did that really make a difference on the tournament condition here, right, for TV show?
Yeah, you know, I walked in like it was a new bowling center for the first time. I really struggled with lane 8. There seemed to be a hold spot down the lane as if the lane was tilted to the right and it just picked up speed. And then when I went back right, it just read the middles too soon. So unfortunately, felt I had a better look on the left lane, but straighter is greater right now. And Liz definitely had a good advantage and threw it great.
And spare making.
Spare making is always challenging. You know, it was like that all week long. It was the hardest condition I've ever bowled on, and it's challenging. You physically try to do things, and it doesn't always work out. You know, operator error, but it was a tough condition, and I'm very proud that I made the show.
Nice bowling this week.
Thank you.
Back to you, Dave.
Kim and Kelly, thank you very much. We really appreciate it, Kelly, and a great effort again, and you'll be back without a question to win another championship. In the meantime, the defending champion, Liz Johnson, and a rising star, Nu Wei Fen, about to face off in match number two. Watch live early round coverage of all PWBA events, plus live and on-demand coverage of all the best professional bowling action on Extra Frame. Visit extraframe.tv for more info or to subscribe today. And if you love the sport, this is a great way to support it with Extra Frame TV. Now, we're ready to go in match number two. Liz Johnson, the defending champion, and from Singapore, 24-year-old Nu Wei Fen. Qualifying average just over 209. Her match play record was 11-13, and a match play average just a shade under 200. Her overall average at 204. One of five Singapore players this week, and a pin. We're missing a pin here. That's what she's waiting on. The 10 pin is not there on lane number 8, the right-hand lane. Yeah, I mean, that's a good point. You know, I thought that Kim's question to Kelly was very relevant about this end of the house that we're at today. Saw no one except our crew. So how does that affect you as a bowler?
I think Kelly, of course, came in thinking exactly what you needed to think. This is a new bowling center. We didn't use these pairs. It's the low end. The temperature is different. The lights make it different. Each end of a house, as we always know, plays differently. Even the pairs that we did use, 17 to the end, when you made the turn, 17 through 24 didn't play anything like 51 through, you know what I'm
right,
saying?
Sure.
It's different. And you had to come in and just say, you know what? This is a new day, new bowling center. I got to watch my reaction.
Take a look at a solid start for Nu Wei Fen. We mentioned five Singapore players. We're going to see another one in the next match. Shayna Ong, who was the number two qualifier, but Jazz Tan was 10. Sherry Tan and Kristen Kwa, who was 77th. And Singapore is starting to make a dent in the world of bowling.
Oh, they've been around quite some time. Their youth program is phenomenal. They train as athletes from a very young age, and they just have so much experience and really have bowled more in the last few years over here on the PWBA Tour, and their experience is coming through. It really is.
wasn't Liz's best shot. She survives with a three pin. Liz Lu, 18 championships overall in her career. And we take a look at the classic form of Liz Johnson.
Liz, very traditional style. Four steps, gets the ball in motion right over that right knee. Looking down, look, does not look at the foul line. Everybody thinks she looks at the foul line, and she says, no, I do not. But look at this. I mean, she just drives with her legs into the line. And once again, everyone watched that. The free swing from the top to the bottom, it just drops. There's no helping that.
It did. Bowling balls tend to listen when Liz Johnson commands them to do things, and she gets a solid strike.
And it's amazing with Liz, because I'm going to tell you, she really creates her ball speed by her feet, moving her feet a little quicker, and not by throwing it with her upper body, using her legs to create that ball speed naturally.
And a little wide, so a couple left behind for New Way Fen. So now we have a little bit of a different look here with New Way Fen.
More of the modern game, five steps. But look at on that second step, gets that ball into the swing. Look at this power position right here with that right. Drives with that right foot and the leverage. What axis rotation off her hand. But if you watch the Singapore, well, a lot, Kelly's the same way. But the Singapore girls do have a little more axis rotation. They're so soft with it at the bottom. And that is so key to the modern game. Ball speed, not pulling down on it, and being soft with your hand, but creating the rotation necessary.
We mentioned her experience that Carolyn talked about. She has been on the Singapore national team, has won bronze and silver. She won Masters and Trio Gold in the Asian Championships last year. She has been in World Games as a youth bowler. Crosses over and leaves the 310. That's what Liz broke up in her opening game. This time she's got that extra 10 pin. She's had incredible success, particularly as a youth bowler, and certainly running into that same success now.
Got this way left of target, and you could see that range finder that's down lane, that dark range finder down lane. Kelly was getting it out to about 9, 10, 11 was the most she got it in. Wei Fen was way left of that, which is why I created that through the nose shot, which just spares a 310.
And made it look easy, which we all know it isn't. New Way Fen was the leader at the end of round four. Liz really fought her way through. I mean, it was like going, we talk about this being a stepladder. She really took step by step, a lot of baby steps for Liz to get to that final five.
Traditional.
Oh, wait a minute. What happened there? That's a ripoff.
Traditional Liz style, she just kind of stays in the hunt, and then blasts them right at the end to make the show. Great shot by Liz, and she liked it too. She leaned right into that. Stone seven.
But the head pin that failed to do its duty there, it looks like. Yep.
Great shot.
The other thing about Liz is I don't think it makes a lick of difference to her what position she is in the stepladder. She's been in all of them. She doesn't care.
No.
Take a look at the U.S. Women's Open tournament format. We kind of hinted at that. We started with 142 entries, 32 games of qualifying. Then we cut it to the top 24, including my partner here, Carolyn. And then 24 games of demanding round-robin match play, and the top five make it to the stepladder finals. Look at match number two. Liz Johnson has already defeated Kelly Kulik. And is now a very close match early on here with New Way Fen. Well, just throw another perfect shot and the pins will take care of themselves.
As long as she keeps that ball a little more going up the lane and keeps her ball speed up, she could be a tough one to beat.
I love what you said about her. We'll take to Liz here in just a second. But you made a great point about Liz. Let's take a look at the New Way Fen shot. It's perfect.
If you watch New Way Fen, hand is way behind the ball, right there. Do you see how behind the ball her hand is? And then she rolls through it. It's really I hate to say this. I mean, I know I'm a competitor, but it's so beautiful to watch.
Oh, sure.
Because it's
that.
Just amazing how much they get on it by being so behind and so soft.
That's got a push, and it does not. And completely different shot on the left-hand lane than she had on the right-hand lane. But another point you made, and I want to get back to the Liz point, but you said it already. Not like these ladies have not seen these shots already coming into the show.
No, and she's probably saying to herself, oh, okay, I just got that one a little far right, just make the spare. I mean, that's really what everybody said. And you're going to see this in the next few matches. It's not always about just throwing the worst shot. It's just that this is the way the pattern plays, and this is what they did all week.
Now, you said something in the first match about Liz. She almost... I'm paraphrasing, but you made it sound like she makes the conditions come to her rather than, you know, she. And I thought that was really interesting because as the day goes on and if she continues to win, things are changing, but it doesn't seem to affect her too much.
No, and I think that's what makes her a phenom. I really do. She can play the condition the way she wants to because of her natural talent. And that only happens to a select few. And that's what just makes her so great. And then when she sees a condition that isn't conducive to her game, she does whatever she has to do to grind out until she feels comfortable and can do what she needs to do.
And you mentioned her classic form. If you can find some video of Liz Johnson from, say, 10, 15 years ago, it's pretty much what you're going to see right here.
Yep, she does not look much different. She still works hard at her game, has kept herself in good shape.
Yes, sir. Liz Johnson, as we get ready to step aside, is making a statement in the middle of this match with a triple, 4, 5, and 6. Liz Johnson with strikes, putting it on the shoulders of young New Wei Fen. We'll see how she responds when we return. With Kim Adler and Karen Dorland Ballard, I'm Dave Lamont. And Carolyn, we want to highlight the difference in the left and the right lanes and how it's affecting New Wei Fen.
She's playing a little bit for, oh, she just moved, I hate to say that, we were looking at the replay, but that's okay. She moved right on lane 8.
This is earlier in the match. We're going to show that as
correct.
First.
Playing the lanes close to the way Kelly was trying to play him from in, maybe a little bit further right of where Kelly was. Starting the ball in about 23, getting it out. This one, left lane, much deeper, about 25. 24-25, getting it right. She moved right, missed the head pin.
Her shooting was flawless. That was close, but she nailed it. Mm-hmm. That's all that matters.
So that's telling you right there she does not like her look in. Okay. So she is going to try to emulate what Liz Johnson's doing, which is very hard to do. But when you feel like you don't have any reaction, and this is the U.S. Open, you only get 10 frames. You only got, what, she have four frames left? You have to do something, and she's moving right.
I asked her what would be significant about this win. She says, you know, I would love a banner. I'll explain that in just a second. Oh, a wrap around 10. The banners that they hang here over the lanes that have your names that signify you as a champion. She'd love one.
Great shot. Definitely going a little more left to right than Liz, but using the same break point. Ring 10. Great shot by New Wei Fen.
Fantastic adjustment. I just did not catch a break, but her spare shooting continues to be solid, which is as much a part of the deal as you have to have in these majors. However, Liz Johnson has been a little bit more. She hasn't had to shoot spares the last three frames. When you think about it, we talked during the break. Her shot in the third on the right-hand lane was perfect. She just got a terrible break on the 7 pin. And she could be sitting on 5 in a row. That's through the face. That one got away a little bit, 3-6-10.
A little bit slower, missed left of target. She's been sitting a little bit. Yeah. You know, we had the commercial break. New Wei Fen was up, so you just got to make sure coming out of that commercial that you're just as aggressive. That's sometimes a tough thing to do.
And this is an important spare. You cannot leave anything behind here. Liz chopped this earlier in the match against Callie Kulik. She's not going to do it this time. Kim, you've been noticing something that New Way Fenn has been doing, and I find it a little bit different.
Yes, if we watch her off to the side between shots, she's actually got herself a book of notes, and every time she comes back from her shots, she's writing furiously in the notebook, which is kind of like the methodical process behind all of Team Singapore. I've seen them all doing this all week, the entire team. So it's an interesting point, and I think she keeps those notes to learn from in the future.
That's Kim, thank you. Yeah, we'll keep an eye on that for the next time she gets up here. Liz with a pretty good shot and a 7-pin right here.
A lot of Team Singapore also charts every shot they throw.
No problem.
And keeps it as they're bowling.
Well, remember the Queens, Bernice Lim?
Yeah.
Was it a Rubik's Cube that she was playing
Rubik's
with?
Rubik's Cube, yes, yes.
So Liz Johnson's clean through eight. And New Way Fenn is going to have to mount a comeback. I'm running out of time. Spares won't cut it. That'll cut it.
Makes the adjustment on the right lane. A little more direct. And like I said, there was a little bit hold, especially from right, not so much in. But it was created more by ball speed, not the pattern, more by ball speed. Little more direct, like I said, using the same break point as Liz, just going a little bit more left to right. But the ball roll she has, being so much underneath it and then getting through it, allows her to play that part of the lane so well.
Max Verneau is 211. And she's on her way to doing that. 221, pardon me. And Liz's max is 236. But New seems to have figured something out. And she's not writing anything down this time. Maybe she has already crammed enough into her notepad for this game anyway. Win or lose, I'm sure she'll add to that journal. Oof, man, so tough. So tough.
Liz hasn't moved very much on the lane, just increased her ball speed and has a great reaction to the pocket. And as you're going to see, people will now follow suit. They're going to follow her lead.
On this left-hand lane, she has struck in the second, fourth, and sixth. And you see what she needs, strike an eight to move on to the next match against Gina Hung.
Great shot.
There's the strike. And now eight. When you think about it, she's actually going for three in a row.
Mm-hmm.
Since there was no Open in 2014, there was an all-star event which Shannon Pluhowski won.
Correct.
But the trophy, we can see very clearly that beautiful trophy there. Could be hers again, three in a row. Needs eight. How about 10? Liz Johnson is moving on to the next match.
Oh, they called a foul on Liz.
Uh-oh.
And I believe it was the first shot in the 10th. She fouled.
Well, that...
That changes the match.
Tremendously.
Let me double I think they need to double check this. Whether it was the first or the second shot in the 10th frame in which Liz fouled.
Well,
the line judge called it.
All right, let's see. The line judge is out of camera range, by the way.
Oh, that's close. Gosh.
We're just slightly behind there. So I don't know.
I don't know if she touched it and then moves her foot right here. Oh, my gosh, it's really hard to see. I'm looking.
Yeah, it is. Let's this see if might we can be
see
a better
it. Let's
angle.
See if we can see it from the front. That could have touched and then turned. I'm glad I'm not the one making that call. But they need to definitely, can they zoom in on it is really the key.
Well, it's,
they're saying yes.
They're going to call it a foul?
They have called it a foul. She has to reshoot the first shot in the 10th.
All right.
I believe it's.
The second.
They're saying it's the second.
Yeah, that's the second shot. So let's see how she handles this.
Like a true champion.
Well, there you go. That's how you handle it. That's all you can do once that call is in the books. Now, let's talk about
the
score.
Let me reiterate. It was the first shot. They are saying now it is a foul spare.
Gotcha.
She will now have a fill frame, which now changes the score. I apologize, too, for the back and forth. We really just wanted to clarify, and I think there was a little confusion whether it was the first or second shot. Here is the foul judge. His eyes are peeled on that foul line. It was the first shot in the 10th in which her foot went slightly over the line. She then spared it, which now changes
the match. Well, this is a big shot. Her
match. Correct.
She gets a strike. She can 260, and now
okay,
something.
Now, yeah. Now the cameraman moved right in the middle of her approach. And she did the right thing. She stepped off the approach, and she's going to regroup.
So she can max at 216. Niue Fenn still is going to have to get some strikes in order to pull this match off. But now she has the opportunity. We went from about 2 minutes ago, her being defeated. So she has to make a mental adjustment as well as Liz has had to make it. Her fill will be 9. So she gets 215, a great score in these conditions. She battled back and handled the call, I think, as well as she could possibly handle it.
Niue Fenn will now need a double. Double in the 10th to beat Liz.
She'll be on the right-hand lane where she struck her last time, of course, you see, in the 8th frame. So she has she made a big adjustment on that right-hand lane as well.
She wound up doing it both on, once she made the adjustment on the right lane, she decided to opt for that on the left lane also.
So you see what she needs to win. Looks good. Oh, dead channel 10. Unbelievable. And Liz Johnson will survive her own mistake. This is a great roll, Carolyn. What happened here?
Great shot. They're absolutely, it's just a bad break. It's a flat 10. Wasn't as flush as the other one. Still a great shot. That is exactly what you're supposed to do on this condition, is hit the 1-3 and hope you carry. And she might have thrown it just a little bit harder. I mean, it could have been something so slight as that, is the ball speed, but it was a great shot off her hand.
Well, Liz Johnson defeats Niue Fenn, defeats the line judge, and shows the poise of a champion. Next up, Shayna Ung, looking for her first major. She's going to have to beat Liz Johnson to get there. And there's the beautiful city of Chicago. What a wonderful place to visit any time of the year. It's our privilege to be in the Chicago suburbs. Liz Johnson moves on despite a foul in the 10th frame to defeat Niue Fenn and get ready for her third match. She started as the number 4 seed. The USBC Bowling Academy provides hundreds of hours of high-quality instructional videos for bowlers of all skill levels. Learn from Team USA and USBC certified gold coaches, as well as other top pros and instructors.
When you're bowling your league, you want to make sure that you can initiate a good, clean, and consistent start. One of the problems that we see a lot of times here in the training center is bowlers have been taught to walk straight up the lane or walk towards their target. But there's some several disadvantages to that.
Right. We want to make sure that you're getting the ball into the swing in the right way. We want that swing plane to be consistent. And oftentimes when you're walking with one foot in front of the other, we start to see just a variance in the swing plane. We want more consistency there. And so one of the ways that we work on that here at the training center is we use this tape to kind of help players get a feel for where they want that crossover step to land.
So we'll use painter's tape because it's non-marking. It gives us a visual reference so that we can keep track of where our footwork is going. What you'll see a lot of times for some bowlers is they will step directly forward. They think they're walking straight, and they are walking straight, but our leg's in the way for the swing. What we want to see is want to see a step in front of your slide foot. That is actually truly walking straight right into the box. It doesn't matter whether you're a four-step or a five-step. A five-step, we would step and still step in front of our slide foot. This will improve your consistency and your overall swing repeatability. Here we have Teresa, and she's going to demonstrate what a lot of league bowlers do when they're told to walk towards their target or walk straight up the lane. On this shot, we're going to demonstrate what we would like to see Teresa do is we want her to have a crossover step or step in front of her sliding foot, enable her to have room for her swing to increase her accuracy.
You can't beat those two, Rod and Kim, for great coaching. Visit usbcbowlingacademy.com today for more information. Coming up, our third match of the U.S. Women's Open, defending champion Liz Johnson against this Singaporean star, Shayna Hung, the number two seed. It's next. So we take a look at the step ladder. Liz Johnson defeated Kelly Kulick in the first match, then 215-200 over New Wei Fan, despite a foul in the 10th frame. And now, Shayna Hung and Liz Johnson, seeds number two and number four in match number three. Of Liz Johnson going for yet another U.S. Women's Open title. It would be her fifth. And looks like Liz, I think, is going to be going first. Carolyn, take us through the explanation of the foul, please.
Okay, I'm hoping I get this correct.
But I'm counting on you.
Basically, once the shot is thrown, you can't go back. So she threw two strikes. She threw a strike on her first shot, strike on the second shot. The strike on the second shot should have counted as the spare for the foul. And then her fill shot should have been nine. So that's really what it is. In other words, you just can't go back. So we're going to readjust the score. It didn't change the match. She still wound up, you know, winning. But that was the explanation.
All right, there we go. So she ends up with a solid four pin in that opening shot on that left-hand lane. And our first look today is Shayna Hung. I'm 26 years old, out of Singapore. She was a finalist, a TV show finalist in the USBC Queens in 2013, was third overall.
I believe the first time I saw Shayna bowl, she might have been 14.
Well, she had a very successful run as a youth bowler.
She was awesome then. I mean, she's just awesome. They all are. Everyone has opted to play to the
right. She goes Brooklyn and gets away with it.
Saw a lot of those this week. You know, when you did make a mistake and your ball was going to go left or right for obviously a left-hander, you were hoping to carry the Brooklyn to get a break. She drifts to the left and definitely shut down on that shot. Missed way left of her target because I know she's going to try to play the lanes just like Waif ended.
The nose, and she gets a 3-6. Well, in 2015, she captured the first gold medal for Singapore in the World Bowling Women's Championships. She won the all-event gold in 2015 in Abu Dhabi. Second place, one pin behind her, Liz Johnson. So there's a little history between these two. 2015 was a huge year for Shayna, really her breakout year with medals at Abu Dhabi, the World Women's Championships, bronze and singles and the gold. And no trouble there with the spare. By the way, any player who can convert a 7-10 split on our CBS Sports Network finals will receive a $100,000 bonus courtesy of Ultimate Bowling Products.
see Liz's consistency. Five strikes each side. High there in the big four.
Way left the target. As you can see, she almost hit the rangefinder on that shot. She's been right of the rangefinder down lane. Ball went right through the nose. Leaves the what we call the big four. Ball gets count.
Tonight at 8 Eastern, we bring you round 8 of Lucas Oil Racing Pro Light and Pro 2 action as the journey to crowning this year's champion of the off-road racing series continues right here on the 24-hour home of CBS Sports. And through the face just a little bit that time. So this is the first slow start she has had. She came out quickly against Kelly and came out quickly against New Wei Fen.
Well, we have a couple games bowled on the lanes now. Could be a little bit of breakdown. She's really trying to roll it off her hand. I saw her talking to Del Ballard, the Storm ball rep, during the break.
Yeah, what does he know?
She was talking. Yeah, what does he know? She was talking about how she had to roll through it. Could have to increase her ball speed a little bit. You know she does that so well. I mean, she doesn't want to move too much left to right. Nobody really did during the week. You really tried to increase your ball speed first before making that big move, because when you did have to move on the lane, it was a big jump. It wasn't two and ones, three and twos. It was, you know, six and four.
Yeah.
I mean, it just, your angles changed everything.
Good looking ball. I thought that was going to make it there. I really thought that had the ability to get to the pocket. We see the results otherwise. This is a messy beast right here.
Really not a bad shot. She got this ball going a little bit more to the right, but just never recovered. Using a ball that's a little bit more smooth on the back end, a little slower response, comes in just light.
How do you make it?
Got to hit to the right of that two pin and the pin to take out is the seven. That's the tough one. But, you know, to the right of the two pin, like you're making the bucket. She hit a little too high on it and pushed it right back. You almost have to be light hitting it to get that seven
slide
out the right
the two
way.
Into
exactly.
The seven. Right.
Right here, it's just a little bit high on that two pin, shoves it right back instead of towards the seven pin.
So both players with opens, and this is the lowest scoring start we've had from two players. Kelly Kulik got off to a little bit of a slow start in her game.
And I look at the score and I go, ooh, two marks out of three frames. Game's going well.
It's the U.S. Open.
I mean, it's the U.S. Open. That's a good score right there.
That's through the face, and she leaves 4-6-7. So both players have struggled now. Is this a result of changing conditions?
I think the conditions are changing. I think that the ball that she is using tends to pick up a little bit earlier. I think she's going to have to make a move or increase her ball speed. If she wants to stay in that area, it's definitely going to be ball speed. She does another one, totally soft with the hand. The ball's getting off, you know, off her hand, doesn't hit up on it. So she can definitely get her ball to read the pattern where it needs to be.
Oh, look how she's out here. And she leaves two there. And every pin matters in these close, low-scoring matches. So may take a note, a mental note of that there in the fourth frame. So Liz Johnson, without a strike, is up 11. Push, down goes the four pin.
Ball comes in high on the head pin, but she gets the break. I couldn't see what pin that was, tapping the four, and it goes to the right and then to the left.
Kim?
So I'm watching Shayna down here. She looks like she's, the last couple of shots, she's kind of done some hand motions when she comes off the lane. Like maybe she doesn't feel like she's throwing as quality a shot. So I have to see if maybe she's thinking that it's more her than the lane condition.
Through the face there, and a 3-6-10 for Liz. We feel like every time they go through the face and you don't have a split, you have a big victory there.
And I believe that's the second time, only the second time, it would be both times this game where she's gone a little high because she went four pin, correct? Four pin, four pin?
Yep, exactly right on this left lane. Welcome to the U.S. Women's Open, where spare making sometimes gets you a trophy. It isn't always about big scores and big strikes. Right now, it's a little bit of defense and spare making and shot making. Let me take a look at the president of the BPAA, Nancy Schenck, who's here in Addison, Illinois at Stardust. And we continue with action. You see that Shayna Ong had another open in the fifth, but did come back in the sixth for the strike. Liz Johnson converted a 6-10. On the right-hand lane, and she's changed equipment and leaves behind a sleeper.
Liz changing to a ball that's a little cleaner, has a little less surface, so it's going to allow her to still play the same part of the lane, coming in just a little light. Two things she'll probably do here, she'll either just stay in the same spot, soften up just a little bit, or she, knowing Liz, because she's so good at it, she could move that just parallel to the right, you know, that two and two, to keep the same angle, stay in the same part of the lane, not have to move.
Well, her spare shooting, accurate, and it has to be right now. And the analogy we always use, I love to use golf as the analogy in bowling, and this is absolute par shooting time right now. And you could go into the woods and leave yourself some open frames, and that's what Ung has done, but yet, she does have two strikes in this match and is in absolute range, 19 down.
And her last shot on the left lane, she also changed balls to a ball that's a little bit cleaner, rocket ship. But she has some surface on it, right in the middle part of the lane.
Yes, sir.
Still smooth off the spot, but just that little bit cleaner so it doesn't force them in a certain part of the lane. Shayna, definitely one of my favorites, five-step approach. Textbook right over the right knee. Look at this power step, and look at how her left knee was almost parallel to the ground. Then she just pushes with that right foot and lets the swing drop, and that's what creates so much power for her. And again, soft off the hand, behind it, rolls through it, modern game.
She struck on this lane last time around. Looks good here. That's 10 straight back for Shayna Ong. And she has recovered from a slow start and has snuck into a one-pin lead. So Liz Johnson's going to have to start to strike back. All of a sudden, spare shooting's not cutting it anymore. Liz, the PWBA Player of the Year in 2015, the return of the tour.
One other thing about the international teams, Team Malaysia, Team Singapore, Team Korea, because they trained, it's their job to bowl. It is their job to bowl. It's about they repeat. Liz making the adjustment, going back to the ball she was using.
Yep.
Staying on top of the spot and just increasing her ball speed. That's what she does well. She's sticking to the game plan.
So the foundation frame, it was nicknamed that for a reason. There's Mabel Cummins, by the way, who is a junior gold champion for under 15. That's a tough event to win, too, by the way.
Oh, my gosh. And if you've ever seen her bowl, she is so, first of all, she's such a young, young talent. And just so cute, so good for the sport.
So's Liz Johnson. And she picks up a double. So she answers right back and throws it right back at Shayna Ong.
Liz missed a little bit left, but got the break, collapses in the 4-9. Look at that, how high that ball was. But gets a little help from the other pins, hitting that 4-9 right out. That's the break you need.
And there's Mabel, she got good seats. You win junior gold, I think we can get you a good spot here in the audience.
Oh.
About to say that's four in a row, but a quiet 10 pin.
Really good shot. Just comes in half pocket. You can see it's not as high as the last shot. Just to the right of that head pin. Pin goes right around the 10. But good shot. Stays on the spare.
Calmly converts that 10. So now we've arrived at the 10th frame. Max 190 for Ung. And for Liz Johnson, 210. Pretty much strike here is mandatory for Ung.
To apply any pressure to Liz, absolutely.
There's always that unpredictability at a major championship. One ball doesn't work out and it changes everything. Perfect.
Great shot by Shayna, and I do believe this left lane seems like they can get the ball just a little bit further left, and there's that little bit of hold. Let's see where she hits here. About 8-9 to the right of that tracer. Yeah, perfect.
That's and one.
And even Kelly went on this left lane when she got the couple of shots in, tripped out the 4-9. Definitely, I'd say, more favorable to the bowlers.
She liked it more, yeah.
Exactly.
She even said that on her microphone. That's trouble there, and she breaks up some potential damage. So a 180 is what she's aiming for. Liz has already done the math. She knows what she has to do. I said, you bowlers know what the score is before the game starts, I think, sometimes.
Absolutely.
Liz is going to have to mark.
I'm going to go out on a limb and say she hits the 1-3. I'm going to go out on a limb.
Well, but she's going to have, you know, sometimes that's been, now she has gone through the face quite a bit in this game and got away with it a few times. And it's left behind makeable spares, so.
She made the move on the last shot on this lane. Got the desired results.
And she went back to her ball of, what's been her ball of choice for every shot but two today. She hit the 1-3, Carolyn.
I'd say that was high flush.
Wow, she saved her absolute best shot of this game for when she needed it the most. That was the Smithfield moment of the match. Liz Johnson has moved into the championship match.
Liz has moved just a little bit left. You can see at the arrow, she's about 10-11. Still pretty direct, keeping her ball speed up. She likes it.
And she likes that one as well. So Liz Johnson's had an adventurous day. She defeated a future Hall of Famer in Kelly Kulik. She survived a foul in the 10th frame and won her second game. And now she will move on to the championship. Can she make it another U.S. Open? The left-hander, Shannon Pluhowski, stands in her way. The words Liz Johnson and winner are not often mutually exclusive. That happens a lot. And Liz Johnson has won three matches, defeating Shayna Ung in that one, 209-180. Now, the outstanding left-hander, Shannon Pluhowski, who's been waiting all this time for her chance at her first U.S. Open championship. She is a two-time major champion winner, capturing the Queens and the Women's All-Star in 2014. She's had runner-up finishes this summer, fourth on the PWBA Tour in points, and her fourth championship round appearance this season. Two superstars of women's bowling about to face off for the green jacket, the check, and the trophy. The championship match is next. From Addison and Stardust Lanes, Liz Johnson, Shannon Pluhowski. We'll be right back. So we take a look at our stepladder. Liz Johnson defeats Kelly Kulik. Then Liz Johnson defeats New Wei Fenn. Despite a foul in the 10th frame, Liz moves on. Take on Shayna Ung. And now for that trophy right there is Liz Johnson and Shannon Kluhowski. Liz, a four-time U.S. Open champion. Shannon looking for her first U.S. Open title, but she does have two majors to her credit. We're going to get a look at the best of the 13 left-handers that made it to this event after we see Liz Johnson. It was the four-time champion, won in 2015 and 2013.
The way Liz is playing the lanes right now is the way she started to play them earlier in the week. Some girls did try to play that 9, 10, 11 area, not so far deep, but it didn't hold up very long. In regards to Shannon Kluhowski, one of the best left-handers, huge fan. Shannon works really hard on her game. She's always been such a natural talent. And to her credit, she was the only left-hander in the field to make the top 24 and played in the entire week.
And she said either oh no or go go, and that's a tough start for Shannon. Well, she was talking to her yesterday. She said, I don't usually play that way. That's not her way, but she had to do it.
Well, that's what the pattern called for, and she adapted to it, which is why she is as good as she is. She didn't like that shot. She said oh no, but it actually was not a really bad shot, just a bad break, and that's really what you had to tell yourself. Probably missed a little left of her target first shot. We'll see if she makes the adjustment.
This, you mentioned it. She is a gifted bowler and incredibly successful. She'll be with Team USA at the Pan American Bowling Confederation Adult Championships in Colombia. This is her fourth TV show this season and is 17th at the Queens this year. But her record around the world, her Team USA record, is phenomenal.
She's a great team member. I had the pleasure of bowling with her for a few years and just a great team member.
And she's searching. Now, let's ask. She's the first lefty. She's got everything fresh on her side. How much of an advantage or disadvantage is that?
It's going to either be an advantage or a disadvantage, and it really is. And I know that sounds kind of like a really bad answer, but it either is going to be what you want it to be and you can produce and repeat to be successful, or you're going to fish a little bit because there's been nobody on your side. So there hasn't been the breakdown. There hasn't been a transition. There isn't a defined area to play.
And she calmly handles that spare, knowing that she just can't let Liz Johnson run away. And that's what Liz did in the first match with Kelly Kulik. Kelly was struggling to find a shot, and Liz was pretty clean. And third game, the game we just finished, and we see Liz, and that, by the way, that's an amazing average. This is a pair that no one played on until today, and a very tough pattern. Four pin's going to be a little stiff that time.
Liz, another good shot, moved a little bit more into the track area. Four pin, great shot. She'll make the spare. She may move maybe one board, or like I keep saying, and I said I was going to repeat some things during this telecast. What does Liz do best? Increase her ball speed so she doesn't have to move on the lane.
19 titles, 7 majors, 4 U.S. Opens, Liz Johnson. Good. 7-pin was a little late, but it took the punishment as well. The U.S. Open Bowling Tournament will take place at South Point Bowling Plaza in Las Vegas, Nevada, November 3 through 9. For more information on how to take part in one of bowling's most prestigious events, visit bowl.com/US Open. Great setup at South Point. That'll be an amazing event.
One thing I want to say about Shannon Kluhowski this week, she qualified 24th. As we said in the open, I mean, think about that. 24th.
She barely made it. She said barely I made it, too.
She bowled to the left of me for the eight games in that morning before the cut to the 24. And I'm going to tell you, her reaction was not the greatest. And she grinded and grinded and grinded and held on there and made the cut and is now leader of this tournament. That right there is a testament to how good of a bowler she is.
She had a great day yesterday to get to that number one position, obviously. She spoke with us earlier about the international influence on the tour right now.
More than last year, the fields are bigger. And then with the international girls coming over, it makes our field stronger. We have a lot of great US players, but with college and stuff, there's so many other things going on. They can't all bowl week in and week out. So the 4 weeks that the international people come over, those fields are bigger and stronger and obviously more challenging, but that's part of it.
Speaking of college, Shannon was a star at Nebraska. Tremendous program there. Equipment change, and she goes through the nose. That messenger will never get there. So I get the sense that she's searching. The problem, Carolyn, is this is the last game of the day.
Well, and you only have 10 frames, and, you know, it's funny. Everybody thinks it's, you know, games are so long. Well, 10 frames is just not that many. And, yeah, of course, you're on a TV show, and two or three go by really quickly.
Well, in talking to players, and, of course, Shannon's been on TV a lot, so is Lisa and you when you bowled. The people who get on television for the first time always say the same thing. Boy, that was fast. I can't believe how quickly that went over. You know, I'm finished, you know, if they don't win. And that's, you know, these two, of course, don't have that reaction because of their extensive experience. I mean, you see Liz here and Shannon have both been championship rounds a lot this year and throughout their careers. That crossed over. I tell you, Liz flirting with disaster there with a 3-6-10. And she gets away with one.
Liz hit about 12-13 at the arrows on that shot. Definitely a little bit left. 3-6-10. We've seen that before.
And she got a late kick on that 10-10 and was able to get it. That was nearly a disaster.
Gets a little help from the pin off the wall.
Any player who converts a 7-10 split on our CBS Sports Network Finals will receive a $100,000 bonus. That's courtesy of Ultimate Bowling Products. Oh, and a wraparound 10.
Right now, all Liz is concentrating on is making good shots and hitting that pocket just like she did all week. Ball cuts right through the middle, wraps right around that 10. That was a great shot. She kept it really direct in front of her. Again, she has created the look that she likes. Started a little bit further right of the track. Just inched her way into the track area. That's where she started this tournament. And you can see her reaction when she does throw a good shot and doesn't miss a little left. She has what she's looking for. In talking with Rob Gotchel, who is the Ebonite ball rep, he says, Shannon, this ball is the ball that Shannon drilled, I believe, on Thursday or Friday. I think it was on Thursday. And she is going to make a move further right on the lane.
Okay.
So we'll see.
Kelly Kulick told me today the truck carried 160 balls.
Exactly. Yep. I mean, there was a lot of balls drilled this week.
Gotta hurry.
So. I actually thought that was a much better shot. Mm-hmm. She did exactly what she wanted to do. She was really free with it. Got it a little bit left. And just didn't quite make it up the hill. A little bit of a tough spare on this condition, but she's a great spare shooter, and she's a great shot maker.
Oh boy, she knew it too. She called for that ball to hook. She knew that that was not her best effort on that one. So another open frame, first and fifth frame she has left open. That one could really hurt. She was within arm's reach of Liz, and you see how narrowly the ball missing that nine pin.
Yeah, ball just deflected off. Very unlike Shannon. She's, like I said, she's a very good spare shooter. She'll regroup.
Down she's all a, of a sudden 27, though.
She has a very good mental game.
And she's running deep into the bag and breaks up a split there. She brings out another bowling ball.
Deep into the bag. Oh, I like that, Dave. Deep into the bag.
Free of charge.
Well, there's plenty of them to go around.
I was going to say, yes. Yes. Shannon's bringing out the entire arsenal, whatever it, but yeah, whatever it takes. That was the thing when I talked to the ladies yesterday. I must have heard whatever it takes four or five times. Yeah. So Shannon Pluhowski still searching for her first strike. The problem is she's running out of frames, and she's up against one of the greatest in the game today, Liz Johnson, who is so close to another U.S. Open title. And that score says it all. Shannon Pluhowski yet to strike through six frames. Liz Johnson clean through five with a 27-pin lead in the championship match here for the U.S. Women's Open. $20,000 to the winner, a beautiful trophy, and a green jacket. And when Daniil Milligan, who's in charge of the event, was asking the ladies this morning, well, what size is for the jackets? Mm-hmm. Liz is very quick with her answer. She knows. She has it
well,
memorized.
I have this in the past.
I have four of these, and I might have a fifth when I leave Addison, Illinois. Especially if you can throw it like that. And Liz now closing in. She senses that the door's been left more than open.
Well, she had a little chit-chat with Jim Callahan and Del Ballard, the Storm Tour reps, during the commercial break. I do think they were talking about that right lane. I think it started to hook a little bit on her, and she just, as you can see, don't think she made a move, pitched it a little bit, increased that ball speed a little. Like I said, the simplest things this week, so you didn't have to move around too quick.
Look out, she gets it, and then that's all right. She'll be happy with that nine pin, I think, after that shot went just a little bit through the face. She looks unhappy, but should be happy with the result, a very makeable spare for her.
Absolutely. Got the break, tripping out that four. And, you know, you saw a lot of that this week. When your ball went high, the 4-6-7 was a split that a lot of the bowlers left. The 4-9, you didn't see many 7-10s. It was hard hits. It was 4-9s. Like I said, the 4-6-7, the big four. Those were the splits that you saw a lot of.
Shannon Pluhowski has just been searching. We, you know, the big question was, I don't think the waiting bothered her. The issue was going to be how she handled having basically half of the bowling lanes to herself. She just walked away from that one. She just now turned to look at the result. Let's check in with Kim Adler.
So I spoke with Rob Cottrell, the hammer representative for her, on the break, and they were talking about off to the side how her nerves seem to have bothered her a little bit at the first beginning, and that always sets the tone for a good game versus a bad game. And she's kind of going through the equipment whether or not she matches up, but the consensus is her nerves are a little up there, and that may be affecting her shot quality.
Well, you saw there just honestly not her a poor effort on that spare.
It is. I you know, like I said, I've had the pleasure of, geez, I knew Shannon when she was well, she's in her 30s now, but yeah. I was going to say a youngin', right? And I also bowled with her on Team USA. She is one of the best quality shot makers I've ever seen under pressure. But this is a little different. It, you know, this is the U.S. Open. This is a professional title. It's a little bit different than, you know, competing with the team. So, you know what, she probably did put a little more pressure on herself than maybe just a normal event. And here's the thing. I think she's going to learn from this experience, which she always does, and she is going to be on TV again.
Oh,
she will be competing for a major championship again. She has had a phenomenal year. Phenomenal.
Oh, listen, the summer is still going on, and
absolutely,
there's still one more major left, so you're absolutely right about that.
Yes.
You know, the other thing we talked about him a few times, we wondered, since these were virgin lanes as far as this tournament goes, nobody bowled on him until today, how would the players handle it, and particularly for Shannon, because she didn't get a lot of time to practice while we were setting up for other matches. Liz has had a chance, as you said, to mold this thing the way she wanted it, and I think she's well on her way to yet another U.S. Open championship.
And one of the factors, there you go, I'm sorry, Dave.
No, for U.S. Women's Open, you see, she already defeated a three-time winner. She still has to do some work to catch Marion Ladewig. By the way, I'm not betting against Liz to do that. She's about to grab number five.
Absolutely. And, you know, here's one of the other things, too. Here's a great, great tip for everybody watching the show today who is a female bowler. Liz never pretends to be something she isn't. She sticks to her game. She makes quality shots. She makes her spares, and that's what makes her great. I think this shot here sums it all up as to what she's feeling. You see a little emotion every now and then out of, you know, out of Liz, and she hooped that one.
Yeah, that was a big shout right there. Shannon? And it's just off the rails for her. Unfortunately, this has just not been her day. Everybody who knows her knows that she has had and will continue to have better days. And she was just talking about how family life, you know, being a parent has put her, changed everything for her over the last few years.
Oh, absolutely.
And how happy she is with that.
The other thing is, and I'm going to tell you, Shannon should take pride in a few things. She is the only left-hander that made that top 24 this week. She is the only left-hander that has bowled extremely well. Andrew Ramirez has made a show, has bowled well. Christina Zerbinski has gotten close to making a show. She's actually mentored some of these younger bowlers to try to teach them how to be more versatile in their game and how to get to that next level. So, you know, we'll see her again, and she will have a major championship in her bag again.
There's no question, and she already has some. There's Megan Kelly, Shannon's spouse, and their daughter is the hit of the tour.
Little Autumn.
Autumn gets a lot of love and a lot of attention.
Actually, her name for me is Autumn / Cutie Patootie, but that's just me.
Well, a hug from Autumn is probably what Shannon could use right about now. So Liz Johnson has done it. And again, there was no Open in 2014, so she has won the last three U.S. Women's Open, 2013, 2015 last year in New Jersey, and now here we are just outside Chicago. And Liz Johnson will take that trophy home. She might as well just hang on to it and bring it with her the next time when the event is. Time to finish like a champ. You see, get a little emotional there. I see a little, I think it's hitter. She's had to fight all the way through. She had to beat two rising stars. She had to beat a Hall of Famer, not officially, but will be in Kelly Kulick. And she's done it again. She is a champion. Yeah, baby, indeed, Liz. You celebrate that one. Another green jacket, another trophy for Liz Johnson, a remarkable champion. Her eighth major championship, and some of her best work has been recently. Queens in 2015, the Open in 2015, the Open in 2014. You know what? She was going to hug Shannon, but first she's going to hug the trophy. She knows where to find that trophy. Five championships for Liz Johnson as a U.S. Women's Open champion. Incredible bowling. We'll be back.
The U.S. Women's Open on CBS Sports Network is being brought to you by A Future for the Sport. The USBC and BPAA are working together to build a future for the sport of bowling at all levels. Visit bowl.com or bpaa.com today to find out more. By Go Bowling. Visit GoBowling.com to find local bowling centers, get tips from the pros, and for all of the latest news and information about your favorite sport, bowling. And by Pepsi, the official soft drink of the PWBA Tour.
From the number four position, she goes all the way up the stepladder to defeat Shannon Pluhowski in the championship to win a fifth U.S. Open championship. And see, that trophy and that jacket go to her collection 19th title. You see Chad Murphy on the left, executive director of the USBC, Nancy Schenck, the president of the BPAA, and standing by with our champion as a champion in her own right, Carolyn Doran Ballard.
Liz, congratulations. You're absolutely magical on the lanes. Okay, different set of lanes. We didn't use these lanes during the week. What was your game plan? Because you play the lanes a little bit differently, but of course, you are the magical Liz Johnson. That's my new name for you. What was your plan?
I just went in and actually went with something that I was going to use, play an area that I played last night towards the end. And at the very end of practice, I went to a little stronger ball and moved a little further right just so I can create a little bit more hook, and it just one of those mistakes that worked out.
I don't think it was a mistake. I think you're that good. Congratulations, Liz.
You.
You're awesome.
You.
Back to you, Dave.
Well, thank you very much. Congratulations to Liz Johnson, winner of the U.S. Women's Open. Be sure to join us this Tuesday, August 9th at 9 p.m. for the USBC Junior Gold Under 20 Championship. For my partners, Carolyn Doran Ballard and Kim Adler, and our amazing CBS Sports Network crew, I'm Dave Lamont saying so long from the U.S. Women's Open Championship in association with the U.S. Bowling Congress. This has been a presentation of CBS Sports Network, the 24-hour home of CBS Sports. Coming up next is the National Amateur Baseball Championship.
To say.